want to say a very warm welcome to Relations of Dependencies. I'm Sarah Green. I'm here at University of Helsinki in Social and Cultural Anthropology, and this is the second Helsinki Knots Symposium. I want to welcome particularly, while they're playing with the lights, I want to welcome particularly our distinguished speakers and discussants, without whom we wouldn't be having a conversation today. And I want to welcome all of you as well, especially those who've already attended two intensive days of conference here and the Westermark lecture yesterday evening. I thank you for your fortitude. And now, my ritual attempt to speak the language of my adopted country for a couple of minutes. Bear with me. Viime vuonna sanoin, että toisin voivani jo nyt puhua teille suomeksi ilman suomalaisen puolisen apua. Mutta se oli liian kunnianhimoista. Osaan nyt lukea suomea ja ymmärrän jotakin. Ja silloin tällöin saan muut ymmärtämään, mitä itse sanon. Mutta matka tämän kielen todelliseen hallintaan on minulle vielä pitkään. Toivon, että palaatte kaikki ensi vuonna kuulemaan, miten olen edistynyt suomen kielen. Tämän kaiken kipperimän, mutta myös kaiken kauneimman solmun selvittämisessä. The issues we're dealing with in this symposium are different from those that have engaged your attention over the last 2 days, though in many ways they are both equally significant. Developing an anthropological voice on issues relating to landscape and materiality could hardly be more politically, socially, and economically significant just now. And developing channels of communications across disciplines that make intellectual sense, rather than simply following the paths set down by official policy, is equally important. This is especially the case just now. It often seems that in the midst of strong rhetoric which says that we're living in a flexible, ever more diverse world, in which differences are recognized and supported, we're also experiencing a distinct narrowing of perspective, a greater control over what is acceptable to say publicly and what is not acceptable to say. Perhaps that's the price we pay for the advent of the internet, social media, and smartphones, since anything we say these days enters an endless echo chamber in which it is seen, heard, and repeated across many refractions and quite beyond our control. It's unsurprising to find an increase in attempts to stop us being off-message too often. Yet, it's so important to be off-message, at least some of the time. It's so important to offer different thoughts which can begin from a different starting point or with different underlying assumptions than what is being officially offered to us. And it's equally important to be off-message in a way that ensures the different voice is heard. So much gets lost in the constant churn of talk, writing, and images these days. And that's what the Helsinki Knots Symposia are about, to create a space for a public discussion about the entanglement between the intellectual issues that are engaging us as anthropologists, as sociologists, as intellectuals, and the world in which we live. It's aimed at creating a different kind of space. You'll notice that although I've set up this debate as a debate between sociologists and anthropologists, already those boundaries have been messed up in the people who are presenting today. There are many disciplines and many crossings between disciplines amongst them. The importance of disciplinary expertise is not in doubt, in my view. But that doesn't mean that the tangles and knots between us don't happen. A regular critique against the idea of maintaining disciplinary expertise is that disciplines create rigid boundaries between themselves and other disciplines, and between themselves and the wider world. The argument goes that in the current fast-changing conditions, such boundaries hold back innovation and need to be removed. Yet both McSherry and Strathern, in their different ways amongst a number of other scholars, have demonstrated that this is a really limited understanding of both disciplines and the way in which communities of scientists develop and transform over time. Strathern uses the analogy of kinship, in which one scholarly community can, through collaboration with another one, give birth to a third, which can then create alliances with different ones, which then give birth to yet more combinations. There is nothing in the logic of specialist scholarly communities, which I absolutely insist we still need, which suggests that people must stay within their disciplinary boundaries. If their understanding is enriched by collaborating with others, that is often exactly what will happen. So today is an opportunity to do that, and I sincerely hope you enjoy the day. And it just remains for me to begin by introducing our first very distinguished speaker, Professor Jane Geyer from Johns Hopkins. And she is well described here in the program, the Armstrong Kelly Professor in Anthropology at Johns Hopkins. But what is said there is so much less than the rich wealth of what she has offered to anthropology and beyond. I don't know whether you've seen, but one of her books so impressed Michel Calon, Marginal Gains, that he wrote, I think it was a 13-page effusive review, and quite deservedly so, of the depth of intellectual contribution that Jane gives. But I think one of the things that I'm particularly grateful for, her work has been with me entirely through the entirety of my academic career, is the clarity of thought combined with the subtlety that she provides. And sometimes that's not always achieved in anthropology, particularly by me perhaps. With no further ado, and with great pleasure, I am introducing Jane Geyer for our first paper, Knots in the Study of Money. Do they strengthen the grip and or downplay entanglements of the threats? Jane, thank you.
Stimulation to rethink some of my own past work and work that is forward-looking. And indeed, Sarah provoked me in a couple of ways to be thinking about the length of my career thought, and also about the origins of the interdisciplinarity that indeed I do embrace. So I thought that I would just start with that. But first of all, let me just tell you that I'm going to speak from quite voluminous PowerPoints. That's worked better for me recently in presentations. Maybe I can keep clarity and subtlety both going at once. Ethnographic particularities as well as threads of thought. So I'm just going to speak from my slides. Let me just suggest to you at the outset that the intellectual themes in the study of money that I've been very particularly focused on are questions to do with the duration of worth and value and confidence. So the particular two functions, in fact, the four functions of money, medium of exchange, means of payment, store of value, and unit of account. The ones that have increasingly interested me are unit of account and store of value. How are those created socially, politically, culturally, and maintained and enacted? And indeed, this comes from my earliest work, my PhD dissertation work, which was about production, about farming systems, about how farmers manage the seasonal cycle, the annual cycle, the life cycle. And let me show you what it was that moved me into money in the first place, which was the instability of the Nigerian Naira. All through the mid-1980s, I was working on production systems. Political aspects also, but not particularly focused on my... Am I all right with the volume here? Here we go. All right. So when I did my first field work in Nigeria, we were still in pound shillings and pence. Then in 1973, the Naira was introduced at 2 to the pound. And then there was the devaluation that happened throughout Africa in the 1980s under structural adjustment. So mandated from the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund in order largely to promote exports, so to make exports cheaper for the rest of the world, to devalue the currency. In fact, I thought that I would add this note that in the mid-1980s, I got a new research grant in dollars. And by the time I went to Nigeria, the purchasing power of my grant was 4 times what it was when I made the budget. So in the mid-1980s, I began to be very aware of the fluctuating nature of money. The whole money could change, and it's value relative to other markets. And then, of course, over that period, the 20-year period, huge devaluation the Nigerian Naira. And the emergence of what they call the parallel rate was an official rate, which was to do with official transactions of the government that was negotiated. And then the parallel rate was for everybody else who worked in domains of the economy that demanded both international currencies and local currencies. Well, you can imagine what happened over that 20-year period, an enormous differentiation emerges between the official rate and the parallel rate, which was then mediated by people making a profit from one to the other. By 2004, the parallel rate and the official rate were, was left to the money markets, although there is still an informal sector of money exchange. I have a couple of junctures interviewed the money changers who work in the street, as they do throughout the cities of Africa. They call themselves Wall Street and International Bank. They give themselves official names. But now, as you can see, I looked up yesterday so that I'm absolutely up to date, that the Naira is at 198 to the dollar. So you can see what's happened to the Naira over the period that I've been involved in Nigerian studies. And so you can see that it's just the pragmatics of my own life as well as the ongoing relationship that I have with the economic anthropology of Nigeria, which gives me the focus that I'm going to develop today on multiplicity, on exchange rates, on conversions. They're there all the time in the economy of the people with whom I've worked. And then, of course, you can imagine the value durations over time become very important. How does this turbulence feed into the prospects that people develop for their futures, economic prospects, social prospects? So hence, it's out of this that we developed the conference in 1992 that became the book Money Matters, Instability, Values, and Social Payments in African communities. How do you make social payments that make relationships and dependencies over very long periods of time with currencies that could disappear, are going to fluctuate against other currencies, that are going to change relative to the prices of the goods that one is selling. So this was the instigation for my move away from production into money in the 1990s. So quickly, I thought that I would go over my relationship with the other social sciences. I have very particularly thought this year, since this is the 50th anniversary of my graduation from the LSH as an undergraduate, that in those days, sociology and social anthropology were studied together. You couldn't couldn't do a social anthropology degree without doing 2 years of economics, and taking exams, without doing social philosophy, without doing social theory, social psychology, or this whole list. And then I wanted to add that this period of LSE history was deeply imbued with two major turbulent world events, one being the post-war period in Europe. Many of our teachers at the LSE in that particular period had been involved in the recrafting or the creation of the post-war manifesto. And so we're speaking to us about policy from a very profound experience. Lucy Mayer, who I mentioned here, had been a colonial functionary, so she knew what it was to work within the colonial regimes. And then many of the students that I was studying with were from the former empire, so independence 2 years ago, 5 years ago, in the case of India, it was 15 years ago. But I studied together with these people. West Pakistanis in those days, Bangladeshis, East Pakistan, Indians, Africans, a lot of Caribbeans. So these were my colleagues. And I think that this, the longer that my career lasts, this becomes more deeply evident to me that this interdisciplinarity and also being very attentive, hopefully attentive, to the intellectual lives of the countries where we are engaged, does come from this particular moment of history, for which I have to say I feel enormously grateful looking back. Okay, let me now get to the subject of today. So what I'm going to suggest here about our engagement as anthropologists with sociology and new work on money, which is quite voluminous, is that the sociologists have taken up the big picture. We had Keith Hart writing big books, the Memory Bank, but on the whole, it's been the sociologists and the social and economic historians who've taken over the big picture questions. And compiling very impressive overviews, either of the theory and philosophy or of the history, and I'm going to discuss a couple of those books here. But as anthropologists, working from the ground up and being very aware of the turbulences of the kind that I had experienced in Nigeria, or that even in Europe we had experienced in the mid-20th century. Some of the aspects of monetary history that we have experienced from below are less evident in some of these, in evidence, in some of these big companies than we might prefer to see them. And so what I'm going to suggest about the knots and the knottedness of our relationship with sociology is that it's both enormously appreciative and has a critical edge to it, which is an opening up to bringing our methods into what seem to be spaces in these overviews. So my orientation is towards identifying very particular aspects in these big compendium that are both helpful, to give a grip on things. And at the same time, they leave spaces that we can see from the ground up are entangled. Multiple currencies, insecure currencies, turbulent conditions, people trying to create durations that go beyond situations of turbulence within these kinds of monetary frameworks. I thought that I would suggest to you that we do have Keith Hart coming forward with a new edited collection called The People's Money, Making a Human Economy, so with the emphasis on the making from below. And I think that this is where anthropological method is so important in the monetary world of today, is to look into these arenas where these entanglements are negotiated. The trainouns is a concept that was a unit of account in the slave trade in West Africa. At the very beginning, it was indexed to gold, an ounce of gold, but it very quickly ceased to index to gold. But it operated for a couple of hundred years as a unit of account in the transactions of the slave trade. So we have here a durable imaginary construct that can then lead us into thinking about, well, do we have that elsewhere, where we have fluctuating and meeting monetary systems, and how do people manage that? How do they create it? How do they manage it? How does it remain in a condition of relative predictability? And these seem to me profoundly ethnographic questions. They need our methods. The question of how do you do that in practice? So, two historical anthropological excursions. I thought of these as field trips, quickly, into some empirical material. The first one, and I've been very interested, have rising interest in the Hanseatic League, and I thought, oh good, I'm in Helsinki. Maybe somebody in the audience will know where to find new sources on the Hanseatic League. It's very striking that especially in the British-based economic histories, that the enormous success and power of the Hanseatic League over hundreds of years is not written very large. The history of money is very largely a national history and not the history of a trade ecumene like the Hansa. And after all, it ran all the way from the Baltic down to, I think that Venice was its southernmost the southernmost city that had a center. And then, since they were dealing with multiple currencies and with long-distance trade for hundreds of years, I learned, looking into the history, that the clearinghouse was in Bruges, in Belgium. But there was a massive clearinghouse system where the accounts were kept and where the currencies that the traders were dealing with were brought together into system, a multiple currency system that worked so extraordinarily efficiently for them over these hundreds of years, up and down the Rhine Valley and all the way into the Baltic. I just found a rather interesting thing, thinking about the big trades of this period, that each different group of scholars claims the origins of capital in a different place, of capitalism. British historians think of capitalism as being created in Britain. There's a very prominent Nigerian economic historian, Joseph Inikori, who has argued with great detail that the profits and the practices of the slave trade are at the origins of capitalism. Without the money generated from the slave trade and from slavery, capitalism would not have developed. And then, lo and behold, reading this paper and thinking I need to know more about the Hanseatic League, I found a book, this one, the Hanseatic League, Medieval Trade and Clearinghouse in Bruges. The book is called Bruges, the Cradle of Capitalism, 1280 to 1390. I don't know whether any scholar has tried to bring these different theories of capitalism together. But certainly it does provoke us as anthropologists to think about how capital was created and stored and maintained in these durational qualities over these very long periods of time in different contexts. And here we have the creation again of a unit of account that had no material counterpart. Now this predates the trade outs in the slave trade. And so we begin to wonder, well, were the traders who moved into the slave trade, who of course were of many different nationalities, did they already know how to work a system with a unit of account that was in some In some accounts, these are called fictional units of account, and in others, they're called imagined units of account. And Luigi Einaudi, who seems, I'm finding, to be not very well known, in 1936, he wrote a very impressive article, that he translated into English in 1956, on imaginary money as having functioned in European trade for nearly 1,000 years, from 800 AD to, he says, the French Revolution. And he says, this will mesh with her anthropological sense of creation from within. Associational life, social life from below, as it were, or from the middle levels, the traders, rather than from the state. The discovery of imaginary money as an instrument of monetary policy was not the work of a theorist, but the result of a long process of historical change. This is the kind of subject that we could put our minds into. Here's The Economist saying that the dollar's rule, the dollar has been the store of value, reserve of asset, but this is fragmented under present conditions. That was a very inscrutable article. The why and in what ways, but is that anything to do with these emergent turbulent situations? And if so, does that affect the ways in which the dollar can be used as a store of value by people in very, very precarious situations? And what about this? Ben Bernanke. Recently, commented that more than two-thirds of all $100 notes circulate outside the United States, making it the world's most popular banknote. Two-thirds, that's enormous. So when the United States is issuing $100 bills, who's issuing them for? And in relation to what concept of the national economy of the kind that Christine Dessin is describing so brilliantly for Britain, or that Nigel Dodd is just indicating this is coming along the way, but we don't know what it's going to look like. Oh, and this is from my news while I'm staying here in Helsinki, that one of our Republican Party's nominees for the presidency, the election, he writes, "I predict we will see people lose confidence in the US dollar. Our currency is no longer the safe haven it once was. Money will soon cease to exist. The dollar will be rendered worthless. There's been a disastrous overproduction and there's going to be a looming crisis." Where is the dollar then in these emergent situations in which it seems to have been either becoming the medium of exchange or in some sense the unit of account? Imaginary unit of account as people developed in the past, and a benchmark against which to measure what they are doing now. Well, these are, if ever you have an example of a tangle, the monetary system of the world seems to me to be it. Multiple tangles. And I think that we have really excellent work being done within the other disciplines. There are just these spaces in very particularly the areas in which there's turbulence and change, and currencies themselves are under various kinds of political manipulations at every level. So the interstices, the interface between those heterogeneous world currencies or national currencies in the world, where those deeply need to be studied if we are to understand the monetary situations of the populations. I thought that I would make a final small thought plug for a collection of essays that I've put together, some of the essays that you'll know, but I am thinking about how composition that I might, in retrospect, think of better as nothing, come about in the world, but also in our disciplinary life. How do we bring together the concepts and the focus of research of different accompanying disciplines with our own, and the experience of the world, and very particularly the common people of the world, under these very changing conditions. So this is where to go next, it seems to me, too. And I think there isn't a single anthropologist in the whole world who couldn't be attentive to the money of the place that they're working in and keep a small file of monetary field notes, and we might then compile them from all over the world and be able to contribute to not only strengthening the grip on these central ropes, but elaborating them, creating more, richer descriptions and indices and concepts, using people's own concepts themselves, their own languages. And that's, I think, as far as I can go with this now. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for the opportunity to come around this rich talk by Jane. And Jane, thank you very much for the paper. My comments are rather remarks, and I'm afraid much of what I'm going to say is just to rephrase your phrased presentation. But let me begin first by commenting in general on the relationship between sociologists and anthropologists in studying money. My personal feeling is that this is an area of research where one can possibly do without the other. Or at least we sociologists cannot do without anthropologists. This is clear. If I think about the major references in current sociological literature on money, such as Nigel Dodd, Vivian Zelizer, or Jeffrey Ingham, they all deplore the relative scarcity of sociological discussion on money, and hence find recourse to anthropologists' writings. To put this in stronger terms, there would be no sociology of money if sociologists were not able to draw on the anthropological literature on the subject. The case of Vivian Zelizer is especially interesting and revealing. Her sociology of money introduces the scale of household, the theme of meaning, and the historical approach to economic sociology, which usually hasn't had that much to do with this theme. And although the general movement currently in the sociological establishment, I would say, is in many respects towards quantitative studies, her cultural approach might be the most influential within the field of the sociology of money. So institutionally, if there is a field where sociology and anthropology are extremely close to each other, it is this field of research of money. But I would like to continue on this and say that it is worth noting that the works of Michel Calon, Donald McKenzie, Garin Knott, Chetina, people who are the leading figures in the social science and technology studies on finance, they explicitly take anthropological fieldwork as the example. So they don't work within anthropology, but they think that the way to go is to work like anthropologists. Right now, I would say that as regards to doing research on finance and the everyday life of economization, it is very, very hard to actually draw the line between disciplines. Not only anthropology and sociology, but also science and technology studies and geography intermingle in a very fruitful way right now. And I see your papers with part of it, all the influences that you use and fields that you yourself influence in are both very heterogeneous. So second, to move closer to the specific themes addressed by Jane, I like a lot the way in which you are able to tie the discussion with economic theory and its main tenets in the specific cases that you know and deal with. It is very easy to agree with what I take as your main point, that is, that what truly is of interest is does not take place on the macro level of structures of social theory, but in the interstices. Or in fact, it is not a case of any scale being more important than the others, but it is the movement between scales, back and forth, that is of interest. So I see your paper to be in line with this. These other people for whom it is important to study situated emergence, yes, but not only this. It should be an imperative for us to move between scales, not to stay on the scale of the big picture, nor on the scale of the very local, not on the mediating scales either, but to move between these scales. But the methodological question that this leads to is, I think, how are you able to do ethnographic work that enables you to move between other scales? That's not only, this implies that the ethnographic work then would not only be about multi-sided, but also multi-scalar ethnography. How do you do this? Back and forth, going back and forth, the size of emergence and the big stabilized pictures, and the way in which these pictures are stabilized to study these emergences. So it's the situated emergence of the big picture. That's the one way to phrase it. Third point, you started your talk by posing the question, how do relationships endure? And I think this is an extremely important question. Relationships are mediated, and money is a very, very particular way of mediating relationships. And to reformulate one of your points is to say that it is not sufficient to study how money mediates relationships, molds them, and makes them possible. It does do it. And it's interesting to study this, what money does. But one has to study simultaneously and symmetrically how relationships mold what money is, the ontology of money, so kind of symmetries of mediation, relationships, how they endure, how money endures, how relationships endure, and how these ways of these things intertwining, creating a knot of endurance takes place. Fourth comment. When depicting the essence of money, the classical economic theory lists three or four items, actually lists two. Money is a means of exchange, a unit of account, a store of value, and a standard of deferred payment.